Good afternoon. Welcome to Resonance Arcade. It's Wednesday night and we are live. And Lou just called me a miserable adult just before we went live, and I want to know why. Why am I miserable? Just because I rant?
Because you've just been ranting about loads of adult stuff all the time. And we're talking about games now, so
I do like to rant. I'm sorry. Yeah, and we are talking about games, and this is my escape.
That was a good, like, 33-minute rant, to be fair.
To be fair,
it was impressive, man, you know, and obviously you need to get it off your chest.
You get to a point in life where you've got so many little things that kind of build up around your adult life that gaming is your only escape. And it's that, again, this is why we do this show, so we can witter on about it. Anyway, to those of you who are new to the show, Resonance Arcade is a show about games. We talk about games industry, we talk about games we've played, we talk about news, sometimes we talk about game development. Usually four of us. Today I've got Steve and Lou with me. Welcome, guys. And it's a bit interactive as well, so if you're watching live on Twitch or Hitbox, get involved. Later on in the show we have a segment about lists. So, well, we have a list basically that we talk about. So if you can think of anything to do with games, so such as favorite protagonists, I think we did favorite mods last week, favorite gaming mods. Something like that, yeah. So that kind of thing, or worst X in games, or whatever, you know, things like that. So if you're listening, you want to get involved, have a think, and we'll talk about that later on. So traditionally, we start talking about what we've played this week, and I think we've all played the same games that we've been playing for the last 5 weeks, plus another game that we've actually hammered to death.
We have, yeah, literally.
Actually, I wouldn't even say to death, actually, yet, because there's still a lot of content left. We're not even in hard mode yet. So yeah, Terraria 1.3, and I know that a few people in chat have also been playing it. I am loving it.
It's great fun. We stopped playing it last time because we kind of got to a point where we had super ultimate characters.
We were endgame. Although
we were endgame, but we were still getting dicked by certain bosses like Duke Fishron.
Yeah.
But we've come back to it and we've started from scratch.
I would like to dick all the bosses this time. I'd like us to really finish them.
But I'm really enjoying playing from the start again. I think it's great fun.
See, that's the best way to do it. If used to, I'd decided to shank half the game when I wasn't playing.
Get stuffed. We have not done much at all. We built the base. That's it, essentially.
Yeah, it's one of these things where, like, when we go and set off to do something, like, all right, yeah, just go and grab a bucket of water, or just go and grab this. And I'm like, right, I have no idea which chest that's in, because I wasn't here when you built the chest.
They're
and
all labelled. They're all labelled.
Yeah, but I've got to hover over every single chest, and there's about 30 of them. So you're like, no, that's walls. No, that's platforms. No, that's wood. And then because they're not in a logical order, obviously.
Oh, no, of course. Cause
there would be a logical order if you could move the chest. Terraria developers, if you're watching, let us move chests with things in it.
Do you know why they don't do that?
Why?
Well, what you should be able to
you'd be able to move chests around like a container.
You'd have an absolute infinite amount. Well, not infinite. You'd have God knows how much inventory.
Let's move it just a small distance then.
Chests need to be more robust, Terraria developers. Get on it. Get on it now.
Everyone likes a nice robust chest.
Yes, we all love a robust chest. Well, just before we finished the other night, I think you went off, Steve. Lou and I just basically went and...
done half the game. And
yeah, we did half
the
game.
We got the Goblin Tinkerer.
Yeah, we found the Goblin Tinkerer. Oh, that was it. Literally about 10 minutes after you left, we were just doing stuff in the base and then the Goblin Invasion kicked off. Oh, no, that was it. We were mining Hellstone because that's what we were doing when you left.
Yeah.
And the Goblin Invasion kicked off. So as soon as the Goblin Invasion kicks off and finishes and you don't all die during it, it spawns the Goblin Tinkerer somewhere in the cavern layer, which is like basically anywhere between ground and hell. And so we went off and found him. So we've now got the Tinkerer's Bench, and that's basically all we did.
What does that allow you to do?
That allows combine you to combine items.
So if you've got an inventory full of things, like you've got the shoe spikes and the claws, you can combine them into climbing gear, which is one item.
That would be
is
handy.
Really handy. Later on, you end up combining loads of items together, and you get like a cell phone, which has got about 10 different things that it does.
Yeah, I've just because I've. I'm going to admit something here. I went into my old world and I got some low-level items.
Put them back.
Well, I can't now because I combined them all.
And you can put them in the bin.
I can't. No. So the only items that I got is I got not an aglet, the other one, an anklet of the wind. And I got the water walking boots, and basically those two allow me to, along with an aglet, which I found in the world, which I think you guys have probably got one of each as well, the rocket boots that you get from the Goblin Tinkerer, and Hermes or Flurry boots, and there's another one actually, there's another set of boots that you can get in this this version of Terraria.
Yeah, the green one, isn't there?
Yeah, if you combine all of those together in a certain order, bloody screensaver, if you combine them in a certain order, you get, with the obsidian skull as well, you get the lava water walking boots, or lava waders, right, or whatever they're called. So you can basically walk on lava, you're immune to lava, you're immune to walking on hellstone, and you can run really, really fast. Oh, and you can jump and rocket up as well. So if you, if you've got 10 gold, yeah, Hermes boots and Flurry boots. But there's another one as well in the new version, in the 1.3. There's another.
Oh, there's the spare boots in the chest.
Yeah, but Steve's already got boots. He was the first to get them actually. Well, that's what I love about this. It's got there's no leveling for a character apart from getting hearts and mana crystals. But we're all full up with those now. As soon as we get to the jungle area in hard mode, we can start getting up to 400 health. But that's the only leveling, really, that and accessories.
Yeah, it's weird that it's a game that feels like it should be an RPG, but it doesn't actually have any RPG elements. It doesn't have the typical stats or anything like that. It's basically what gear you've got determines how good you are.
I think it's really well done and really well balanced as well.
Mm. And also, there's just a lot of content. I was making the comparison with Minecraft. Now, obviously, everyone knows Minecraft, and a lot of people play Minecraft. But as a game, Minecraft doesn't have a lot in it, whereas Terraria has a lot in it.
Don't say
Minecraft.
That.
Minecraft's got three dimensions, but Terraria has got a lot of dimensionality in just the sheer amount of content. And also, it feels like a game. The biomes in Minecraft kind of flow into one another. They look very similar, whereas in Terraria you feel like you're entering distinct locations with their own music and colors, and it just feels more
different
like a game.
Enemy types and that type of thing.
Yeah.
And
you can also, as we already knew anyway, but you can also just create your own little biomes if you've got enough blocks and you meet certain conditions, and bringing NPCs is the same. You have to meet certain conditions in order to. I really love it. I really love everything about the game. And
I also like exploring it. In Minecraft, you walk around and you start to notice the patterns, whereas in Terraria, although it's fairly simple Perlin noise cave generation, it feels like you're exploring a unique place. It never feels procedural, which is really nice.
Yeah.
It's one of the few games I've played, I think it's probably the only game I've played procedural-wise, apart from maybe the original XCOM, where it really doesn't feel procedural.
Yeah, I think it feels very natural, the world, and I could regenerate a world as many
natural,
times as I want.
Natural, but not boring. Natural, but not repetitive.
Oh. Well, there's no repetitiveness from what I can feel. There's no prefabs or anything like that.
Does it not always have the same elements in, though, whenever you spawn, like, a world?
Sometimes. No. I mean, we've been looking for a world which has got a pyramid in it, which is quite a rare thing to appear in a sand biome, and we haven't seen one yet.
No.
When we started this, we built, you know, the sky path in order to find the dungeon, so you must have been pretty certain that there would have been a dungeon there.
Oh, there's always a dungeon.
There's always
because
a dungeon,
that's part
yeah.
of the
so
main. Right, okay,
is there
so
always a lot of things in this?
There's always a sea on each side of the world. There's always chests in the sea as well, at least one chest. There's always at least one floating island. There's up to seven, I think. Well, this is
up
as
eight
per 1.2.
Large world, yeah.
Is it eight now? Right.
Yeah.
Oh. So, yeah, there's always a certain amount of floating islands.
There's always a jungle.
There's always a jungle, and
there's always a lizard temple as well.
Yes, somewhere in the jungle.
Yeah.
There's all when you kick off hard mode, however, hard mode always spawns the hollow in a V shape from the center of the world, so you've got two streams of hollow that go through all of the other biomes that are there. There's obviously some commonality there, but it's still, I mean, the dungeon has to be there because you have to fight Skeletron and you have to go in there to get the mechanic, who then provides wires in order to do traps and various other bits and bobs. But in terms of the procedural generation, There's not always a crimson, there's not always a corruption. They're always interchangeable. The ores, even though the ores are interchangeable, for example, iron and lead are interchangeable.
Tin,
I think.
Yeah, yeah.
Tin and tungsten, possibly.
Yeah, That's right, yeah.
Maybe, something like that. Anyway, the ores are all swappable, and nearly all of them. I think gold and platinum are swappable as well, for example.
Silver, gold and silver, isn't it?
Even the... No, it's gold.
No,
it's
silver
platinum,
and copper, isn't it?
No, silver's further on than copper. But anyway, it doesn't matter. Everything's got an alternative, but that's what makes it cool and different and a little bit more interesting, because even though I've played a world with all of the... played different worlds with all of the different ores in and all of the different biomes, it's still interesting discovering which ones are in this world. And then all of the chests, obviously, are procedural. You always know that you're going to get water walk... you're going to get ice skates in ice chests in the ice biome. You at some point... gold chests hold certain types of items, so if you want certain types of items, you still have to kind of grind for them, but that's the closest you get, really.
What I'd say I played the game when it first came out, pretty much, and I sort of played it for about 5 minutes and thought, I don't like the look of it, I don't like the feel of it, I'm not going to play it anymore. If you've got it in your Steam library, and most people will have it in the Steam library, get a friend and just start playing it with a friend. You will really...
yeah, forget if you don't have friends, just go and find one.
Go and find a friend. Go and talk to someone on the street who smells a bit funny. Say, do you want a game of Terraria?
Can you play Terraria with me?
You will enjoy it. I guarantee you'll enjoy it, unless you don't like those sort of games, in which case, I can't guarantee that. It. Yeah.
So there's no guarantees that you will...
So there's a guarantee. There's a guarantee that there might not be a guarantee. Yeah.
My experience of Terraria, and I think I've probably said this on the show before, was when I first went into the game, I've spoke to the guide dude, because you spawn in the middle of the map with a guide, and it's just a dude walking around who's got a random name.
Harley, isn't it? On ours?
No, it's always different. Yeah, I don't know. He died when I threw him into the... when I threw the guide doll into hell, and the fucking yeah. ball of flesh spawned.
You killed
accident.
Harley, you bastard!
That kills the guide, and then he respawns as another person. Anyway, I've spawned, and it said you need to make a house. The guide said you need to make a house with walls and a ceiling and a background. And I'm thinking in 2D. No, sorry, it didn't even say background. It said walls, a ceiling, and doors. And I was like, right, okay. So I made some walls and a door. And I was like, how the hell do I make a wall? What's a wall? Where I put walls on the side where the doors were. And I didn't realise that there was an actual background to it as well, so it's like a 2.5D kind of world. I had to actually look on YouTube initially to figure that out.
Well, I had to do that with Minecraft, though. I mean, I walked into Minecraft the first time, I didn't realise I had to punch a tree a few times in order to get going. I was like, what the hell do I do?
Well, I didn't know how to chop trees down, not chop trees, take backgrounds down for ages, or alter blocks within Terraria.
It's amazing how quickly it becomes, like... easy, though. It becomes second nature, whereas it's quite confusing when you first start playing these games.
So the next time that Lou actually ventures into the wilderness, the first thing he's going to do is run over to a tree and start punching it.
I am, yeah. I mean, that's what I've learned that you just punch anything and you will get raw materials from it.
Yeah,
well, didn't Savage Lands have that kind of thing? But
yeah, Minecraft has it. If you punch a pig a few times, you get a pork chop.
Yeah, nice.
That's how butchery works.
I might try that.
That's why people are always going on about animal cruelty. Just punching chickens to try and get a parvo.
For those of those uneducated on what parmos are, they are a Teesside delicacy. That just look it up. Look up Teesside parmo on Google. In fact, so one of you two can find a link and post it in chat.
No, I'll let people Google it, because you might find some horrible pictures of
nastiness. Yes, apart from Terraria then, I think I did play a little bit of Witcher 3 earlier on this week, but I'm not sure. I can't remember. I think I might have just hammered Terraria since last Wednesday.
I've played a bit of Witcher, which is always good.
Yeah, no, I'm not certainly not dissing it. I'm still loving it. I'm pretty sure I haven't played any. I certainly haven't done any more of the main quest. But I was kind of at a point where I'd done almost every side quest that I could get my hands on, apart from just the random question marks in Skellige.
See, I'm starting to go around them now.
Yeah.
Purely because I'm not sure whether it's a bug or whether it's just something I missed. I've read a few reports saying that certain things are randomly generated, but I'm still missing a few superior oils.
I've got one or two, yeah, but that's where they come from, those question marks. Yeah.
I'm missing. I've made a list.
I haven't done
Spectre,
that far yet.
Beast, Cursed, Elemental, and Drachnid. Superior oils.
Haven't got Elemental. Elementa.
Now, I've looked at a few locations that people said they've found them online, and they haven't been in them locations, which makes me think that it is that they are randomly generated. 100%
is randomly generated, because I was looking for one in particular. I think I had my superior and my enhanced beast oil, but I didn't have the first one. And it wasn't that I missed it somewhere, it's just it just happened to spawn randomly later on in the game in a chest that was more difficult to get. So yeah, it's weird.
So I'm in the position, I'm at the point now where I'm trying to find all the chests, because I'm the type of sad bastard who doesn't really feel really comfortable with myself unless I've got all the oils.
See, I was just looking at an article from a few weeks back on The Witcher, and it basically says that the DLC is almost as big physically as the existing world in The Witcher, which concerns me a little bit, because I don't really want to continue playing The Witcher for the rest of my life. I do want to at the same time, but I don't have time because of all the other games I've got to play.
Yeah, there is. It's kind of quite lucky, because at the minute there haven't really been any massive releases. Obviously, there's been a Terraria update, but there's been nothing new really that's come through. I mean, like, if, for example, this would have been released at the same time that a new Metal Gear Solid was released, you'd have been fucked.
What, me? Yeah, well, I would, but to be fair, it's not too long until Metal Gear Solid 5 comes out. It's only a few months now, really.
Yeah, but you'd have had your fill of The Witcher by then, I imagine.
But I think I could continue playing the DLC, though, that's the thing.
I was actually considering toying with the idea of starting from The Witcher 1 again and going through all three. Yeah. I know, it's terrible.
I want to play The Witcher 2, though, you see. I don't want to play 1.
Isn't the 1 not very well regarded?
1 did have a cult following. It's the control interface that a lot of people didn't like about it, but the story was still solid.
I think I remember watching someone playing it, and it had a weird sort of, the way you attacked, you had like two different attack buttons, didn't you?
Yeah, so you had a quick and a slow attack, and
weren't there a mouse wheel by default or something?
No, it was just left and right click, I think.
Alright.
If I remember rightly. It's been a while since I played it.
What just pointed out that Batman was released.
I don't like Batman.
Yeah,
it's awful.
You're awful. Anyway. Yeah, so that's it for me, really. I've been looking at some other games and thinking, should I play some? I still got a load of my Steam account that are on my, in my, I've been promoting things to my favourites as I want to start looking at them. I think there are actually some games in my Steam account that I'll never, ever, ever, ever play. Pretty convinced of that. Well, I keep thinking I'm going to go through them all and give them all a go at some point, but
There's some games that I haven't even installed yet.
I've installed everything. And the way that I work is I install everything, and as I complete them or as I get bored of them, I'll uninstall them. There's games like Deus Ex, like Human Revolution and things like that, that always stay installed because I always like to have a good old bash at them, you know, but yeah. Okay, so nothing else we played, so let's move on to the Way of the Exploding list.
Yeah!
Oh,
that was a very smooth camera shake there, Steve.
If my computer's on dampers.
Ah, you see. So does anybody in chat have any ideas for a list, or does anybody in the on the show have any ideas for a list?
I had an idea a while ago, but it's a little bit of a lame idea.
Well, I've got a few lame ideas written down, but I don't really want to do them, so I'm not going to tell you. I'm not going to tell you what they are.
Well, it doesn't look like we've got anyone in chat. So the idea that I had was
top 5 favorite things to do in The Witcher.
No.
Top 5 favorite was actually Witcher oils.
Favorite. Yeah,
what are your favorite Witcher oils?
my favorite has to be Necrophage. We did actually say this a couple of weeks ago. It's the only one that you use almost every.
Yeah, because you've got Drowners, you've got Neckers.
Water hags.
Yeah. Bile hags.
So great. The idea I had was favourite swords.
Master Sword. Zelda. Wabbajack.
When I think about it, there's some excellent swords.
Wabbajack wasn't a sword.
No, it wasn't, you're right. But there was another one in Oblivion that was amazing.
From Morrowind, there was a Crescent Blade, I think it was.
I had that one, excellent. Yeah. That used to
stun people.
Soul Calibur, Soul Edge.
Oh, God, Buster Sword.
Buster Sword.
You can't not have Buster Sword in this list.
The Master Sword.
That's the Zelda one, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm looking up this Oblivion Sword because I'm sure I can't remember what it was. Not their balls. What the hell's wrong with you?
I'm trying to look at what swords are on my t-shirt, but they're all upside down.
Oh yeah, you've got a load of swords. That was completely unrelated, by the way.
Subliminal.
I see Soul Edge in there. Buster Sword on the right. There's a Master Sword.
Soul Calibur. Soul Edge.
Well, should we say Squall's Gunblade as well? Why not?
It's got a blade.
That's an interesting one. Yeah, I had a friend who was like a sword fighter, and he really loved that blade, even though it's really improbable. Like, you wouldn't fight with a curved handle on a sword. But he seemed to have a thing for it.
What other swords has there been?
What about the one in Castlevania? Oh, energy sword. The Halo 2 energy sword.
Lightsaber!
Deus Ex, the one with the nano.
Oh, that's what I was trying to think of. The Dragon's Tooth.
Dragon's Tooth
nano sword. I love that weapon. Once I had that weapon in Deus Ex, that's all I used. Everything fell from under that sword.
Tranks like, all robots. The way. Tranquilizers all the way.
I went from
game.
A baton to the Chinese metal sword to the nano sword, and once I had the nano sword, that was it. Everything just fell to it. It was brilliant. But yeah, the Halo Energy Sword's a good one.
Yeah, Wood Potato Powers mentioned that in chat.
Yeah, especially with all of the crazy stuff that's come about from the sword flying and things like that.
The Terror Blade from Terraria, which is the 1.2 kind of best sword you can get. I have it. It's the one that fires swords from its from its end, and it's really, really fast. And basically, you can destroy any boss within seconds. That is ridiculous. I should bring it into the world just to show you briefly, just so you can see how fucking stupid
if
it is.
You do that, then I'll be bringing my scythe in, which is ridiculous.
I've got one of them
as well
now in my other character, because I think it was a what was it the?
It was a rare drop on a thing during the one of the undead events, wasn't it?
I can't remember what the event was though. Not Blood Moon, the other one. Not the pirate invasion.
No, it was an undead invasion.
Pumpkin Moon? No, we never did the Pumpkin Moon.
No, that was ridiculous, wasn't it?
That was one we didn't actually have. We never had that occur while we were playing it.
I'm sure it happened twice when we did it.
Yeah, it did, because I got a sword as well.
Right.
I got the blade, sorry.
Any of the swords in Chivalry, because they're all equally fun to use, but possibly the Vanguard two-handed sword was pretty good fun.
There you go, it was the Eclipse drops from the Grim Reapers, but the Grim Reapers in which event? What? Which event was it?
God of War does flailing things that Kratos uses.
They're not swords.
The things you hold in your hand and they got a sharp edge. If we're having the gun blade.
Yeah, that's a blade.
These are blades that are attached to chains.
A cheese knife is a blade, technically. That's not a sword.
Yeah, if there was a cheese knife as a weapon in a game, you'd call it a sword.
This is my sword. Yeah, the solar eclipse, that's it. Chris, see?
Solar eclipse.
Yeah, it was the eclipse.
Is that must be a hard mode one then? Because we haven't seen it yet, have we?
I remember
game.
It was a bit bitch actually. Yeah.
Yeah, it was a lot harder because we had.
Although the enemies didn't really jump very much, so I just ended up stuck like in a little bit of a chasm, firing down at them. I seem to remember, so I didn't have much trouble with it.
Tell you, apart from some of the like the goblin invasion where the wizards spawn and the grim reapers, and the wraiths, it's pretty easy if you just build pits on each side of your base, like we have done this time as well.
Got a good pair of pits.
Got a good pair of pits. I still can't find this bloody
sword. From the Soul Calibur series, the one that turns into a whip.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not keen on that. Not keen on her as a character in general.
Nah.
No, but
I'm not keen on the game, to be honest.
I like Soul Calibur 4.
It's only because
I
used to kick your ass at it every time.
I prefer Battle Arena Toshinden and Tekken. Tekken came out 17 years. Tekken 3 came out 17 years today, I think, or very recently.
Tekken 3?
Tekken 3. 17 years ago it came out on the PlayStation 1.
Tekken 3 wasn't on the PlayStation 1.
Yes, it was.
Tekken 3 was PS2, I'm sure.
No, Tekken 3 was PS1.
Oh.
Oh,
no,
you're right.
97?
That's good.
And for the PlayStation, 98, September 98, but yeah.
Umbra. That's it. Umbra.
Umbra, that means a bell.
That's what I was looking for. It took me ages to find that. And the Blade of War as well. That had a... Was it the Crescent Blade in that, that used to banish them to Oblivion? Or was that the Blade of War?
I don't know.
Oh, and the Debaser as well.
So, Umbra... Alright, okay. Yeah, there's a fair few melee sword things from game, but the one that I wanted to...
Go on.
I was just going to say the Dragon Tooth from Deus Ex really hit the nail on the head for me. It was a beautifully done weapon.
I still think Buster Sword or...
That's iconic, but as a weapon itself, I mean, it's a...
Well, it's a starter weapon. But okay, well, let's go for Omni Slash then. The Omni... It was called the Omni Slash as well, wasn't it?
No, the Ultimate Weapon it was.
Ultimate Weapon. Yeah, that's it. Sorry. Oh my god, such a noob.
Mass Immune,
eh? Yeah. That was only two slots, quadruple growth or something, wasn't it?
Nah, yeah, I'm thinking about the Mass Immune from Final Fantasy. I'm thinking about the one from Chrono Trigger.
Oh, okay.
There's one of those in Terraria as well, the Mass Immune. Oh, yeah, I think so. In the dungeon, it drops in chests. It's in chests. Pretty sure of that. Anyway, should we move on?
We shall, yeah.
Let's move on to the
news. I thought it was a little bit lame, that one.
Oh, it's all right. It'll do.
You're not allowed to make any more suggestions, Luke.
Yep, that's fine by me.
Right then. So, let's move on to the news. It's a bit of a slow news week, to be fair, this week. I think we're going to be struggling to fill 2 hours this week. Because we haven't played many more games as well. It's been a bit of a funny one. Okay, so Humble Game Making Bundle. I actually looked at this when it came in, but go on, Lou.
Well, yeah, I sucked this one in. Just, it seems like it's not a very good game making bundle. I think probably because all the best game making tools at the moment are free.
Well, on top of that as well, there's I suppose a full engine at the end of the day is free. I mean, you can get Game Maker for free, and that's pretty simple to make games with.
Yeah,
and you get Unity for free, and that's
so the stuff we've got here. We've got Game Dev Starter Pack, which I think is a load of assets and things like that. We've got Stencil, which I've never heard of. RPG Maker, which has been around for donkey's years in various forms. Game Character Hub. I don't know. Play Canvas. I don't know. ProMotion. I don't know. So it's like, it's not a very good bundle, really, but it kind of... I find it interesting that they've got enough of a market, that there's enough people that want to make games.
I think there's a lot of people out there who finds the idea of making games something that's very appealing, but then when it comes to the practicality of it, then probably haven't got the patience, the skill, or the
it takes a
resolve.
Lot.
Yeah,
it takes
I
a
think...
lot. I mean, I have all those things, but even I'm really disheartened at the moment by game development in general.
There always has been that, but normally that fervor has been pushed towards modern, and now it's not. Now it's about making your own indie game and being the next notch and getting, you know, $1.5 billion off Microsoft. And
I think that a lot of people are quite quite conscious of how saturated the market is at the moment, though.
Well, it's a very indie-led market on PC at the moment. Mm. I say indie-led, it's indie-saturated, like you say.
But it's starting to come through for consoles as well. I mean, I switched on my Wii U for the first time in quite a few months this evening. And after a flurry of bloody updates, as soon as you go onto the store page, it's all indie stuff, you know, the latest indie games, this and indie that, and a few of them are crossovers from the PC, but there's some unique Nintendo stuff there as well. And obviously with the modding stuff getting released on the Xbox and whatever, I think that's when you're going to see more and more indie games coming out. And the fear I've got of it is that it's going to turn very much into like the mobile phone gaming market, where it's just about making money and about microtransactions and this, that. It's just shit.
Yeah, and it's about putting the same the same marketing messages. I mean, like, yeah, you know, epic bosses.
Yeah.
Epic
how many different versions of Flappy Bird can they actually be before people start to realise that it's just another version of Flappy Bird?
Not so much Flappy Bird, but I mean, have you noticed that Snake is taking a bit of a revival lately? Everyone's making a Snake clone.
I haven't noticed that, but I've noticed that these builder games, you know, like the Clash of Clans and those kind of games.
Clash of Clans had adverts in the London Underground.
Yeah.
How the hell does a game
Candy Crush is on the bloody TV. It's on adverts.
Yeah, and so is Clash of Kings. Like, it's ridiculous.
Not Empires. That was a good game. What was Age of Summer?
Prostitution.
Age of Prostitution?
Restitution.
Oh, right.
There's, on the plus side, though, Minesweeper's making a comeback as well.
We'll be happy about that.
There was a few weeks ago, what wasn't in the chat.
We had a
Minesweeper thing. It was something to do with
a roguelike Minesweeper crossover. Yeah. You got Minesweeper on your. So that. Oh wait. So the Duke. You can actually create apps for Windows phones, and I didn't realise that.
What? Of course you can. You're taking
it's
a piss.
No, because there are no apps. There are no official apps for Windows phone at all.
You're talking out your ass there, because you can get anything.
You're talking out your ass.
Just because you're still on Windows 7 and you don't know what the App Store is.
I'm glad.
You do realise that the Xbox Marketplace is part of Windows Phone.
Yeah.
And you do realise that come the release of Windows 10, all the apps that are available for iOS and Android are going to be available for Windows Phone.
Yeah, yeah, they've done some deal, haven't they, with Apple or something like that.
It's about time, to be honest, because Windows is sorely lacking. It's the Windows Mobile is a great operating system. It just has very few apps on it.
Last time I used Windows Mobile was 6.5, and it was awful. It was absolutely
But anything
awful.
But anything below 8 was terrible anyway.
Right.
Anyway.
Sad news.
You're still running the gay iPhone anyway.
Yep. I hate it.
Some sad news now, and we all know about this if we're interested in anything to do with gaming and you look at any of the websites. It's all over the place at the moment. The chief exec of Nintendo, Satoru Iwata, that's how I'm going to pronounce
Satoru
it at least,
Iwata. Yeah.
Has died at the age of 55.
Yeah,
that's
he's
not
quite
old,
young.
That, is it?
So talking about the mobile stuff, he was actually one of the people who pushed Nintendo to start doing this make this deal with mobile phone manufacturers to get Nintendo content onto those phones. He did that fairly recently as well.
Right.
After holding off for a long time.
So that's probably what his dying wish was. He had to do that before he died. And then
he knew he was dying. I think he had cancer of some variety. But,
oh, really?
Yeah.
But it's a shame, isn't it?
Did anyone see the picture of the rainbow above the Nintendo headquarters as well, day after he died?
No.
Probably quite poignant. There was a picture posted on social media of a rainbow above the Nintendo HQ.
I saw the post on Reddit from the Japanese embassy in Russia, where people had laid loads of flowers and put loads of Nintendo figurines around it and stuff.
There's an interesting link between Russia and Nintendo with the whole Tetris thing, isn't there? Mm. Like a very weird, tenuous game-related link, which is quite interesting.
Mm. I mean, obviously this isn't going to affect Nintendo too much, though. I mean, they're a monster, aren't they? They're not going to...
And Nintendo do not seem to be led by any one person, like a lot of Western companies. I say Western in a Western different map. Sense, yes.
Chris has learned something today, by the way.
Yeah, we were referring to... Western. We were talking about Japan, I think, earlier on before the show, and Steve referred to it as Western, and I was like, it's not Western, it's Eastern. No, you referred to it as Westernized, didn't you? And I wasn't sure. I'm still not convinced Westernized is the right way to describe Japan. Sounds racist to me.
Racist?
You are racist.
Yeah.
Anyway. You are, like, he is probably racist.
Anyone who ever see anything where racists are involved is racist.
If I read the colour black, I assume it's racist.
You look around to make sure no one's watching before you read the colour black.
Do you only buy grey paper?
I do, yes, you're right.
Skies of Azeroth 360 degree video on YouTube. I'd never seen a 360 degree video, but yeah, basically you play the video and you can look around in a video with the controls of the D-pad at the top corner.
Oh, really?
So this is a tie-in with I didn't even realise this, or maybe it was in the back of my mind, but there's a Warcraft movie coming out next year.
I didn't even know that. I didn't even read that properly. Go on, sorry.
So yeah, there's a Warcraft movie coming. It's already been filmed. It's in post-production, but it's been held back because of the imminent release of the new Star Wars movie. They don't want to clash with that. So it was going to come out in December, and now it's going to come out middle of next year.
I totally watched this video. I didn't click any of the links, and I was like, this is boring. What the hell is this about? Well, this isn't a movie trailer.
Does this only work in Chrome?
Yes. So there's a proper trailer coming for this in November. In fact, there's a link in here where it's already been...
Yes, I found it was shown at Comic-Con last weekend. And obviously people have recorded it on the phone at a jaunty angle, so...
I can guarantee, this is a proper guarantee, but I'll guarantee that this movie will be diabolically bad. If you look at the actors that are in it...
About Minecraft?
Now, the guy who directed it is the same guy who directed Moon, which was a good movie, but...
Moon
was
completely awesome.
Completely different scale to Warcraft. But this movie's going to be so bad. I know it's going to be so bad. Just... No... It looks like. Do you remember the Dungeons and Dragons movie from the '90s? I think it was.
That was terrible.
That was terrible, and this feels like this is going to be like that as well.
If you watch,
those are Americans in really bad costume armor.
No! It's a CGI film.
It's not fully CGI. The orcs CGI.
It looks like it's fully CGI from what I've seen, but
I haven't seen the trailer. But I've seen
a pregnant orc there.
Yeah, there is a pregnant orc.
That's what no one needs to see.
Right. Well, I'll have to watch a trailer, but I can already say that it's going to be a bad movie. I just know it is.
It, to be fair, I mean, as far as game tie-ins go, it looks all right on the face of it to me. I'm not saying I'm going to enjoy it because I've no particular interest in watching game tie-ins. But
what has mentioned the Warcraft cinematics? Now, Blizzard make some of the best cinematics of any company ever. I remember the original World of Warcraft cinematic, the intro. And I remember getting goosebumps from it. It was amazing. And I've always liked them. I liked the StarCraft reveal trailer as well. That was fantastic. But
they've always had good CG, but the problem with that, it's not a standalone story.
Yeah, if they could turn that quality of stuff into a feature-length thing, that'd be brilliant. But that's not what this is going to be, I don't think. This is going to be...
It looks, from what I saw of it, it's quite a long trailer. From what I saw of it, it looks quite good from the, you know, from the poor quality.
There's a lot of talk and a lot of hype come from the studio about it being groundbreaking and CGI.
It also sounds like they've got very good voice actors, etc. So, I mean, you know, if you're into that kind of thing, go for it.
I'll definitely go and see it, but I don't know, there's been several... Yeah, Warcraft games that have been released, and each one of them has had an individual story. Obviously, it's always humans kicking ass of orcs and the Scourge Elder coming in and all this type of stuff. So, do we know what the story involves? Do we know?
It's orcs and humans, isn't it? It's telling that story.
They go through some kind of portal, I assume. It's
doesn't that happen at the beginning of World of Warcraft?
Frozen Thorn.
Yeah, number 3.
Probably. Yeah, it does. Yeah.
Frozen Throne's the add-on, so...
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh god, I'm awful.
It's Warcraft 3, Frozen Throne was the big add-on.
I'm not a big Warcraft guy, I'll be honest with you.
Okay, but yeah, so... I'll watch that trailer and maybe revise my opinion, but I'm pretty sure that's going to be a terrible movie. If it's entirely CG, then that's a little bit better, because the actors just are all unknowns. I've not heard of any of them. There's not a single, like, starring role there, but maybe... Maybe it'll be alright, but I don't think it will be. I think it'll be shit. Uwe Boll wanted to direct it. He wrote to Blizzard and said, can I direct it? They said, categorically, you will not direct this movie. We're not going to give you the rights to this movie.
What? Why? Why does he get involved with everything? What?
Because he's a troll, isn't he? He's just a troll now. He just goes around just trying to make shit movies.
Just like trying to be awful.
Got a really good idea there. Let me direct it, and I'll turn it into the shittest movie you've ever seen.
Yeah. All right, Mozilla Firefox blocks Adobe Flash by default. Now, hasn't Chrome blocked?
Chrome
Flash
has been doing
recently?
This. Yeah, Chrome has been blocking it on certain sites on certain different things, and I've noticed it's been a bit of a pain in the ass to use Flash on Chrome. But Mozilla now has blocked all versions of Flash categorically by default.
Now
I've said categorically way too many times.
Chrome on my PCs, my laptop and my PC works fine with Flash, but on my tablet and on my phone, just Flash just refuses to work, especially on embedded sites.
Flash hasn't worked on mobile devices for a while, I don't think.
It used to work fine on
that. But they stopped updating it because it required a custom build of Flash because it's Linux-based, isn't it? Android.
Right.
It doesn't have a proper official Flash binary.
Fair enough. So, but
as far as the Mozilla thing goes, I mean, anytime you go into a site that contains Flash, it just comes up with it. Like, do you want to allow this? Yeah, I want to allow it.
Latest versions now just block it by default.
But HTML5 is supporting video now, anyway.
Version of Mozilla right now.
The thing is, it's not about video. If you look at people who play games on Facebook, and there are a lot of them, they're all Flash.
That's because they're all tards.
99% of the games on Facebook. Look at all the games on Newgrounds and all the stuff like that on what's the other one?
No one plays games on Newgrounds anymore.
Not Newgrounds, but there's other ones, isn't there?
There's loads.
There is Kongregate, and there's another one that I'm trying to remember the bloody name of. And it's oh god, I can't remember.
So this makes for good viewing. Shall we move on?
Well, yeah. Basically, there's the whole browser game market, which is going to get completely wiped if everyone rallies against Flash, which is what they're doing. Because the head of Facebook also wants to get rid of it. Or
why though?
Cheat CTO of Facebook.
Just because it's difficult to support? Is that the only
reason? Insecure is what they're saying. They're saying that it's basically a security concern. Because it has file system access and things like that. They can't control it because it's a closed binary.
Is that related to the Silverlight thing?
Silverlight is
Microsoft's own version of Flash.
Microsoft basically said they want everyone to stop using Silverlight.
That was announced 3 years ago. Silverlight's an obsolete technology that only the finance industry still use. I don't know why they decide to still use it, because it's horrible. But yeah.
Probably because all the developers are .NET developers.
No, you'd be surprised. There's a lot of finance places that aren't .NET. But
it just means that the Flash is basically going to get wiped off the face of the earth. And I think that's quite a bad thing. I mean, I don't want to play Flash games. I'm not a fan of Flash content. But to preserve all this old stuff, I think there's got to be something, because there's no real way to convert it.
Hmm.
So you're going to suddenly lose a lot of content off the internet. And you're going to have to basically install a custom browser or a custom plugin to be able to play them again, which is a shame.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of old Flash games that I used to play. So that one I talked about before, that Ghost Hacker, which is a tower defense game. Thoroughly enjoyed playing that. I played it through the story quite a few times.
Probably Kongregate! Kongregate,
you
thank
did
you.
Say that. You said did Kongregate earlier.
Did I?
Yeah.
I'm sure I didn't.
Yeah, we'll rewind. Someone remind.
Okay.
You guys don't care, but I was hoping Sam would be here to kind of rally with me for this. Metal Gear Solid 5, again. Konami has now totally removed everything to do with Hideo Kojima and Kojima Productions.
It's like a really bad breakup, isn't it?
It's really bad. It's like they've now removed it from the box art. His studio's been disbanded. He's basically been fired. In December, he's leaving. And he's always been a contractor, I think, anyway. But yeah, well, he's finishing up his contract and then he's gone. But to remove the studio name, it just feels a bit petty to me. You know, it's like it's his final game with the studio, probably. Hopefully, he keeps saying it's his final game, but hopefully, it's like, can you not just let him have that last one thing? Maybe he's a dick. Maybe he's an absolute dick.
You know what the Japanese are like with final things. We're on Final Fantasy 16 or something now, aren't we?
Right. Well,
how many finals can we have?
I think there's a bit more to it than that. I don't think there was. He was just talking about I think Metal. I think he started talking about in 3, saying that 3 was maybe his last one. Then he did 4.
And, so link to Konami's new business strategy. I've just put in the chat.
Oh, go on, let's have a look at it. Yeah, basically, yeah. Very good.
It just kind of feel like, you know, like one of those really nasty breakups on Facebook where people delete all of the photos, and it's like that, isn't it?
Nasty,
like,
go through
and erase all of the history.
Yeah, I just think it's a little bit sad that it's ending that way. I mean, doesn't matter what kind of fallout they've had, he still, I imagine, put the effort and organ, you know, designed the game. So why not give him that last thing and then that's it, he's gone. But maybe it's an honour thing. Maybe it's a different culture to us, isn't it? So maybe that's just what it does. Maybe he's been dishonourable in some way and they've kicked him out because of that. But we'll never know the full truth, I don't think. Maybe in 10 years' time when he has a rant on Twitter, an unprofessional rant.
I'd love some crossover to be with Dishonored now. Another stealth game by Hideo Kojima.
Oh, he'll do...
Dishonored developer!
Didn't get that till just then. Awful. He's going to move on to bigger and better things, though. There's no doubt about that. There'll be people screaming out for his expertise.
Would you say that people, Metal Gear Solid fans, follow Kojima rather than follow Konami?
Yes.
Yeah.
100%.
Okay. So
Kojima
they're fans
is synonymous with Metal Gear. I wouldn't be surprised if... I mean, I'll play Metal Gear Solid 5 anyway because it looks like awful. It looks like a wonderful game. But I wouldn't be surprised if some fans, you know, the purists, boycott it because of what Kojima have done.
Gamers are the worst boycotters in the world.
Oh, yeah.
We cannot boycott anything.
You're right.
But then we all go out and buy it.
I don't know. I've boycotted Ubisoft. I can't see them releasing anything that, again, in the future that I'd want.
If they release, you know, Assassin's Creed Millennium Gigabyte fucking Thrust Pirate Ninja Edition, you will buy it. What? And you'll get the special edition.
What?
I would buy any game called Thrust Pirate Edition. Thrust Pirate Ninja Edition, sorry, that's even better.
I wouldn't, because it's got Assassin's Creed in the title. Right, the Division. The Division interested me. I mean, Far Cry 4 interested me, but I haven't bought them because it's Ubisoft. Now, I might accidentally buy a Ubisoft game. if I forget.
I accidentally
have my credit card. Yeah. No, you know what I mean? I might accidentally, like, I might forget when I get, like, senile and old and buy a Ubisoft game, but I am boycotting them because they are fucking idiots. I've had enough of Ubisoft shit. I've had enough of the stuff that they release.
If you ever buy a Ubisoft game again,
next week will be
an announcement, and I'll be.
Luke is allowed your shit in your mouth.
Isn't the new Deus Ex a Ubisoft published game?
No, it's.
It is, isn't it?
It is.
No.
It is.
No, it's not.
It is.
It is.
No, it's a Square Enix game.
Yeah, they're what Ubisoft published.
Eidos.
Eidos, is it Eidos?
It's Eidos.
I think it's Ubisoft, I'm sure of it.
Nah, it's not, and if it is, then I'm going to hang myself.
let me just check. Eidos Montreal.
Yeah, I see.
Publisher Square Enix.
Because it says Montreal, you got it mixed up with Ubisoft Montreal, didn't you?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
I thought Ubisoft had some...
No, they're allowed to have a little bit of involvement, but I'm talking about a published and a game that's developed under
see,
Ubisoft.
See, the rules are starting to get changed, you know.
I said published.
They're allowed to give you a little grow, brother.
If they are developing it, that's my rule. If they develop a game, unless they come up with a... Right, okay. Let me qualify this. Unless they come up with a new formula of game that isn't the same bollocks... That isn't the same, climb a tower and open this area and then climb another fucking tower and do this and then go and do all these side... Another... The Division's going to be that, isn't it?
Did you ever play the South Park game, Chris?
Yeah, yeah.
Did you enjoy it?
No. Well, I enjoyed it to a point, but it was very, very repetitive. It was a fan service. It was very good at making you feel like you were in South Park. But yeah, I got to a point with it where I was like, I can't even be asked completing this or going anywhere near the completed side of things. Why? Is that a Ubisoft game?
Yeah. The new one's going to be Ubisoft.
Yeah, I'm not getting the new one. I'm sorry, but it's... they've done it for me. It's just one person. I'm sure there's a million other people that will be buying games in my place, but no.
This is why we're the worst boycotters after fuel boycotters.
Yeah.
Who buy more fuel when they boycott fuel?
Let's boycott fuel. Let's go buy all the fuel, and then we'll boycott it after we've got enough.
Yeah. Okay. This is something I found quite interesting. PlayStation, the PSX, the original PlayStation CPU, is used in this new probe that's on its way past or just past Pluto.
The New Horizons. You haven't been following this at all, have you, Chris?
I didn't. I've heard it on the news. I don't follow it. I'm not interested in shit that doesn't happen in my house.
Disney.
Sorry, say that again.
I said they mentioned Pluto and he thought they were on about Disney.
Have you seen this photoshops of Pluto on Pluto?
Yes, we have.
Yeah, it's awful.
I have anyway.
Awful.
There's been a myriad.
But I thought it was quite interesting that, you know, they use it an old, even though it is probably. Apparently, the article goes on to say that NASA like using tried and tested stuff rather than cutting edge CPUs and this kind of thing. I know it's 10 years old anyway.
It's definitely not cutting edge.
Doesn't need to be cutting edge, does it?
It's do you know how fast that CPU is?
Something like 33 megahertz or something.
12 megahertz it is.
Yeah, it's somewhat ridiculous, but still for that, it's quite impressive what it does, isn't it?
It is, but the thing is, the interesting thing is that when New Horizons was launched, the PlayStation 3 had just come out, so they had access to faster. I think the PS3 had was that the one with the Emotion Engine? Was that a normal CPU in it?
They had access to Intel, IBM processors. Yeah. That's the point. Is that they needed something that was tried and tested and solid. They don't need the power; they need the reliability for these kind of things. And obviously, they have to modify them so when they're in space, they're not going to get bombarded by boson particles and everything else that hits them, you know. But it's, you know, it's still gone. Correct me, Lou. I can see your face going.
I just love what you pulled boson particles out of thin air.
Because those dangerous boson particles that we wouldn't.
I'm on a boson free diet at the moment. Actually, I'm really scared of boson.
Fuck your face.
If I'm on a ship and I see a boson, I think shit. Made a boson then.
You have too many bosons, you'll sink.
Any more?
Too many bosons. Spoil the boss. Sorry.
Don't worry, Chris. It's not your intelligence that we like you for.
I never claimed I was intelligent. I'm very practical. That's my.
You're pragmatic, Chris, aren't you?
I wouldn't say pragmatic either. Certainly not that. Xbox One and PlayStation 4 gets Prototype 1 and 2 bundle. Again, you guys probably don't care about this, but it's interesting that they've brought out a game that was fairly pop. It was fairly bigged up at the time when it came out. What?
sorry. It's something that Steve's put into the chat.
Okay.
I'm gonna put it.
Just trying to make a little laugh.
You did.
Is this another in joke then that you're not including?
No, I'm putting it in the chat if I can find it.
So yeah, the Xbox One and the PlayStation 4 gets Prototype 1 and 2 HD remakes. These are games that were, again, fairly popular. I think it was PlayStation 2 that came out on, I think. One at least, anyway. I think 2 might have been on the PlayStation 3. But again, Sam was a big fan of them and that's why I've got them in the chat. I was hoping that he would be able to come in and go, ooh, might get that. But it's one of those games that kind of skipped me by. I played the first one in his copy, but
I have got a Prototype game. I'm not sure which one it is. I think it might be Prototype 2.
Prototype's the one where the guy transforms into things, isn't it, and jumps off buildings? Or is that not the one?
He has like a mad suit, doesn't he?
A bit like Venom or something? Isn't he like an alien morphing thing?
Yeah, he's an alien. He's been affected by military testing. And he's basically a weapon. He's a weaponized person who's got all like alien blood and shit, and he can turn all of his basically everything into loads of different weapons. So he has there's loads of different morphs that you can do. But it came out at the same time as Infamous, and it was a direct competitor with Infamous. And I think Infamous kind of won the war a little bit, but it's got a very distinct cult following.
I remember Prototype having the definitely having the marketing behind it. I remember it being publicised quite a bit when it came out.
Yeah,
but it just disappeared.
Yeah, it did disappear. And I said I I just thought it felt a bit flimsy when I played it, but there's a HD remake. I mean, the voice acting was awful in it. It's like the worst B movie voice acting you've ever heard in your life. It's horrific.
There seems to be quite a lot of these HD remakes coming out at the minute. And is that because of a pure lack of original content, do you reckon?
Of course it is.
Well,
obviously it is.
It's like, haven't they, or aren't they going to be releasing a HD remake of The Last of Us, which was in HD?
They've already
done that, yeah.
Yeah, but it was already in HD.
Well, I think they updated the textures, didn't they? They made it sharper. Well, they actually use high-res textures.
It seems like all...
HD doesn't mean the resolution anymore. HD just means better than before.
Yeah. Yeah, because everything's HD now, isn't it? Or at least... Yeah. At least... What do you call 720 then? Because there's standard HD.
It's HD and full HD.
Right.
Full HD is 1080p.
SD is 480p, isn't it?
Because we've got 4K and cinematic. We've got ultra high definition, which is 4K, and then we've got cinematic 4K, which is 4K plus a bit, plus an extra bit of width resolution.
Well, 4K is actually 4K, whereas the ultra HD is 3800 something.
Something like that, yeah. No, ultra HD is 4K is not 4K. It's near 4K. So I've got a full cinematic 4K monitor, and the resolution is I'll take it back. 4096 by 2160.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's more than 4K, but 4K in terms of computer.
Yeah.
Computer terms. Okay, right, so The Witcher 3 latest free DLC is the Ciri outfit. We talked about this last week. They did an accidental leak and said, don't download it, it's not ready. And then they've released it properly now, and that's it. That's the only DLC that they've got.
So am I right in thinking that all the outfits so far have been for the female characters?
I was going to mention this. I was going to say, why? I mean, no, Geralt. Geralt has got his an alternative look as well.
I was going to say, because the male character that you play as, you can change the costume to anything you want anyway.
I guess so, yeah.
But there's plenty of other male characters in the game.
But aren't all the other main characters female characters, though? Like, all the ones you interact with on a large basis. It's all female characters who... Like, female sub-characters who lead the plot, isn't it?
I say, there's Dirkstra.
Dykstra.
There's Dandelion. He's a main character.
What's the revolution guy called? The one that used to run the Redanian army. Forgot his name.
Yeah,
I wouldn't say not fat guy. That's Dirkstra. Dirkstra. Right. Oh, fucking hell.
Dykstra.
You
should know this. He's a Pathfinder.
I know. And the thing is, I struggled to say it when I was doing a bloody video on it a while back, and I still struggle to figure out how to say it. His mate that he does the plot with.
Gary.
It might be Garrett.
Gerald and Gary. Gerald
from.
Yeah, I just want to anglicise all the names in it. Jennifer and Gerald.
Yeah, but he. Yeah, you're right. I'm thinking about it. There's a lot of main characters that are male, but there's a lot. The main characters that you interact with are all female, aren't they?
Yeah.
Well, there's Vesemir.
Who's Vesemir again?
That's the old guy.
Old Witcher.
Yeah, but again, you talked to him at the beginning of the game, and I imagine you talked to him again when you go to Caer Morhen, but...
You do interact with him a fair bit, but all the other witches, they're all from certain schools, so their kind of gears set.
Yeah,
I do get the feeling that they're aiming this DLC, or they're aiming the game in general, towards a male audience, and then unashamedly doing so. And I'm glad that they are doing that, actually.
If
I'm
you
glad
play The Witcher
1 folding.
Or The Witcher 2, both of them games, basically, it was part of the game to sleep with as many women as possible. Mm. In the first game, you got trading cards for every woman you slept with.
Yeah, I remember that, yeah.
I like that. I think it's a ballsy move in this current climate, but it means that they're sticking to the guns and... making a game with a very definite story. If they'd kind of made it so that it was feminist friendly, then the story would have been quite diluted.
I thought you didn't like that aspect of it, the fact that it's forcing you down that particular route.
I respect the thought behind that, though. Just although maybe the lack of thought, yeah. the can't don't give a shit sort of thought behind it, because they're a small studio in Poland where the world hasn't really caught up with them yet.
I don't care. I'll be honest with you, one way or the other. Yes, I agree there's a lot of sexism in the world in general, and I wish that the world was different. But I can't even say that it doesn't affect me, because I'm a white Caucasian, you know, I'm a Caucasian male who living in England, for God's sake. I'm probably one of the most privileged group of people in the world, so I don't really have an opinion, unfortunately, on it.
Okay.
Shut you up, didn't it? Let's move on. Okay, and there's no date for the new Witcher 3 patch either.
Has there been any more information on the new alternate movement mode?
That's in the new patch.
That's the patch.
People have been asking CD Projekt Red about the new patch. When's 1.07 coming? And they've responded with, "We will let you know. Shut up, you whingy bastards."
I did hear something today about the gravity being applied to the horse now as well.
Oh, right. Okay.
So, because of the
easy way of getting down a mountain, though.
Yeah, well, now it's an easy way of breaking all four of Roach's legs and having to shoot him at the bottom.
So does that mean that you're going to get falling damage from a hop being on a horse?
Probably. They just said the gravity's going to be applied to the horses as well now. So I assume that means that you're not going to get the weird horse physics anymore.
Or it might get even worse.
Well, it probably will. It will get worse in the fact that you'll be falling off a cliff all the time.
Yeah.
On a horse, which is ultimately hilarious and tragic.
Steve, you said that you couldn't get downhills on the horse, but I can get downhills if you wangle.
I can jump off hills,
wangle it right, you can get down any kind of hill, really.
You've got to really coerce the horse into doing it, though.
Yeah.
But that's just like real life. I mean, if you're trying to get a horse down a mountainside in real life, you'll probably have to coerce the animal.
I'm quite looking forward to it, especially if you can select between the two movement modes and play around with it.
Yeah, I'm definitely interested in a different movement mode. If it's any better than what's there at the moment, that might get me playing it a bit more.
Yeah, I said I've only not played it because of Terraria. and my gaming time has been almost solely concentrated on that at the moment. Dead Island 2 dev, Jaeger, has been dropped by Deep Silver, which are the publisher, I believe? Or are they like the main developing house? The first game was developed by a company called Techland, which then went on to do a number of other games, but went on to do Dying Light as well. But they've now dropped this, and that basically means there's no developer, but they're still saying that they're going to develop it. Now, this is interesting to me because I played the first one with my wife, and I'm actually probably going to get the second one because I quite enjoyed it. It wasn't as shit as everybody kept going on about. Fair enough, there's a few bugs in it, but still alright.
What's happened to the Dying Light? Because that had a massive impact on everyone, and then just seems to have disappeared again.
That's what AAA does, mate. Have you not noticed that?
I have noticed that, and it's becoming slightly distressing, because I remember when AAA used to stick around for a couple of years. Now they stick around for a couple of weeks. Flash in the pan like that, and Titanfall and stuff, that just come and go before you even know what the hell's happened.
Because there's so many games, because the attention span of gamers is ridiculously low.
I think it's because these all live and die on the marketing campaign, and once the PR and the marketing stops, then the game stops as well.
Hmm. Well, there's also the fact that the developer and the publisher have made the money, so why do they need to put any more effort into it? And they stopped developing it, and people who, you know, if they've left bugs in the game, people who are playing it and sick of the bugs, they won't continue to play.
I do not like this disposable game malarkey.
Neither do I.
Spending hundreds of millions on a game that will be around for a couple of weeks, a load in its first, you know, month, and then that's it. That's made the money back and move on.
But then we've also got the other model, which is the free-to-play model that makes millions over longer periods.
Over many years,
by basically providing you shitloads of shit content that's just aesthetic. So we as gamers are quite discerning. There's a different groups of gamers, aren't there? There's the gamers who play these fly-by-night games. There's the gamers who get addicted to one game and stick on it forever. The Call of Duty players, the FIFA players, you know, that kind of thing. I'm not saying that they don't play any other games, but generally there is a type, you know. There's a lot of people I speak to that, there's still some people I know that play Destiny, you know, and I imagine it's still quite big, you know. Was that a scoff or a...
Oh, I don't know, I've never played it. I've never even seen, apart from the before it was released, any gameplay of it since release. I don't know what kind of game it's really.
It's a first-person
It's somewhere
person
between
shooter.
A first-person and a third-person, isn't it?
It's no, it's a, well, I think you can go third-person, but there's a it's a first-person raid 'em up, essentially. It's like it's like playing instances in World of Warcraft constantly.
And on the face of it, it sounds like it could be a good game, but...
It's just console, isn't it?
Yeah, it's only PS4, isn't it?
No, I think it's Xbox One, isn't it?
Is it on the Xbox?
I don't know, you know. I really don't know.
I think it might be...
How awful am I?
I thought it was PlayStation exclusive.
I think it was, because it was quite controversial with Bungie obviously doing something for...
Defecting. Basically. Sorry? Defecting, basically. Yeah. After being bought by Microsoft.
Not platforms. PlayStation 4, Xbox One, PS3 and 360.
Right, okay.
Just console, though. You'd have thought that kind of game would appeal to PC gamers.
Bungie have very rarely... In fact, Bungie haven't themselves ever made a PC game.
No, they've just
ported
it,
haven't
they?
They've got someone else to port it.
But if they make something for the Xbox One, then surely it can very easily be ported onto a PC these days.
It'll probably be developed on PCs, but that doesn't mean to say they'll do it, as we discussed the other week.
It's a shame. Well, it's not a shame, because I'm not that bothered about Destiny. It doesn't sound like something I would want to play personally. And I'm not just saying that as a miffed off... nose in the air PC elitist. Does not appeal to me as a game.
Just going
to
boycott that along with Ubisoft.
Well, I don't like Bungie games anyway. Halo, I've never really rated personally. I'm amazed.
That's because you are wrong.
I'm amazed you guys are as into it as you were. But then again, Lou, you do play some shit. You do play some like repetitive kind of FPS type games. You know, you just want to shoot something over and over and over. So I imagine Bungie. What's its name? Destiny would appeal to you, thinking about it. You're shit, basically.
All right, okay.
You're not a real gamer anymore.
I felt that vibe when you started.
Okay, this is something I just noticed just before we went live, but Randy Pitchford's had a bit of a Twitter rant, or people have started attacking him about Colonial Marines when that was released, and saying that it was a flunk, you know, it was a flop. But he's basically, they started saying that he's... they're reacting to all of the news stories and media and stuff that's been put out over the last few years or the last year since it was launched. And he's responded with, I put 10 million of my own money into this game and lost it all. So stop having a go at me. I didn't do this to...
If he had to put that much money into the game himself, he probably should have known it was going to be a flop. He should have looked at what George Broussard did with Duke Nukem Forever. Because he put a load of the money, basically reinvested all the money they made from Duke Nukem and all the licensing of Duke Nukem they did in the interim into a game that was basically, you know, a bottomless pit.
I mean, I haven't played it yet. Have either of you?
It keeps popping up on, like, my recommended games on Steam, and I keep kind of getting a little bit tempted, but I'm not paying a tenner for it.
I remember you were quite interested in it. I think we all were quite interested in it before it came out. It looked like it could be the alien game that finally delivered.
You know what I'm glad of? You know what I'm glad these days? That I have grown up a little bit when it comes to games, and I'm not pre-ordering. Now I've made that decision in my life, even with the big games, like the ones that I know I want to play. Metal Gear Solid 5 is a prime example. I'm glad that I haven't pre-ordered it, because if it comes out and it's a flop and there's loads and loads of reviews saying it, I won't have wasted 60 quid on it. I won't have wasted X amount of hours playing it and realising it's awful.
It's really interesting that, because Watch Dogs was the first game to make me realise that I really shouldn't be pre-ordering games. Now, I don't normally pre-order games, but that game made me realise that a game that looked so amazing beforehand could actually be so terrible.
You know what did it for me? Another Ubisoft title. Watch Dogs was Ubisoft as well. Another Ubisoft title. It was Assassin's Creed 3. I bought that game based on lots of previews that I read. I bought the limited edition kind of... So I got the collector's edition because you got some cool stuff in it, and I enjoyed the previous games. I enjoyed Ezio's story, which was two revelations and revolution or resolution, I can't remember. There's three games with Ezio in, and when I played three, I was so vastly let down by the story, by the protagonist, by the bugs. There was an insane amount of bugs in that game, and the fact that it was nothing new in it apart from it had the frontier, you could climb trees. Ooh. You know, And now I just watch Ubisoft's Assassin's Creed trailers with a snarl on my face. I literally just sit there going, fuck,
I don't
you.
Know where it annoys me. I mean, I played the first one and it lost me at press X to climb over the city. When I realised that that was the entire mechanic.
It was...
Where it lost me was when I left the first city, went to the second city and thought, oh, I've already been here, haven't I?
Okay, well, again, I was quite amazed by it. I was enamoured by the climbing mechanic. I was like, this is pretty cool, the fact that it looks as good as it did. And then when I played the first one through, because I kind of got to a point where I was like, right, I've got to complete it now. I played lots of the story. The main story is interesting. It's an interesting concept, at least. And then I got into it from 2 onwards. And then when I played 3, that's the spoiling moment. That's when it just went, add enough. I did buy 4. But I don't regret 4. I don't regret buying 4.
I got Black Flag 3 with a graphics card.
Yeah, so did I, after I'd already bought it for the PS3. But it's broken on PC. Or it was utterly broken on PC. Plus, it doesn't feel right playing an Assassin's Creed game on PC to me. Something wrong about it. Yeah, so... 10 million of your own funds, though. I mean, is that his own funds, or is that his own company? Or what, you know?
If he's saying his own funds, I assume that means his own money.
I don't know.
Now, I'm surprised that he had 10 million to start with. I mean, Randy Pitchford, you know, Gearbox have made some successful games, but I didn't think they'd been so successful that he alone had amassed 10 million worth of money that he could invest in a game.
Maybe it was the company's money.
In an alien game at that, like, for Christ's sake.
They
haven't had a good run, have they?
No, not really.
I mean, Alien Isolation has been the best one, and that's not great.
No, that's had pretty positive reviews.
It has, but I've played it and it's not brilliant. It's all right. It's a good looking game. But it's the best of a bad bunch.
Yeah. Well, what about Alien versus Predator? We had quite a lot of fun playing that multiplayer.
I only played it at one LAN.
We had quite a lot of fun playing really gay maps on Quake 2 as well, but yeah. It doesn't mean to say that they were good.
Yeah.
We had a random laugh on them.
Okay, fair enough. But isn't that what gaming's about? Having a good laugh. Don't
yeah, but the single costs, player so. Campaign was crap.
Oh, is this Quake 2?
No.
No, it's just Alien vs Predator.
Quake 2 as well, but I still
yeah,
like
I'm
it.
Say,
still occasionally bunny hop through the entire game just for a laugh. Actually, no, I get about 3 levels in and then I go map boss 2 and then nail the boss and that's it. Done. Okay, so last story of the day. No Man's Sky dev talks about hype, pressure, and turning down extra money. Have any of you read the article to start off with?
I've not read the article, but I have watched the gameplay video from last week.
Right, okay, so not really as relevant, but... I haven't read it in a great amount of detail, but... What do you think in terms of the hype? You know, are we?
I think this game is almost entirely based on hype. It's based on people's misconceptions of what procedural generation is all about.
Yeah,
and I think he knows that. I think he knows that's. I think that's why he's been quite coy with the game until recently. You know, he's introduced. There's a video that I've been meaning to watch that I haven't watched yet about the economy in there. But the economy will probably be about as interesting as Elite Dangerous is, and Elite Dangerous has demonstrated that. An economy doesn't make a great game. It maybe did back in the 80s when the original League came out, when procedural wasn't even a word that people knew, and it was just like, oh my god, there's the entire galaxy in the game. But these days, it's like people want more. And by more, I don't mean just lots of it. More as in more different things to do. You can't fob people off with procedural unless it's done in a very clever way, like Terraria's done it. And Terraria... Although it's got its procedural stuff, the main thing is it's got lots of content. It's got lots and lots of things that people have created by hand. So,
I mean,
No Man's Sky doesn't have any of that.
It's arguably easier to create 2D content because all it is a sprite and some kind of object definition
which
in
is
the background,
why,
isn't it?
Which is why it went for the pixel art style as well, because it's quick to make pixel art. But No Man's Sky, you know, the hype... wagon that it's on is driven by lots of people's dreams of an entirely explorable universe without really realizing that procedural universe isn't going to be very interesting.
Here's an interesting quote from the developer. But of course, this isn't the actual quote, but of course, some gamers have gotten carried away. Murray said he can't do anything about this. Quote, they project their own idea of a game onto what we're doing, he said. Maybe that's the nature of the hype. Runaway excitement that can never be matched. It's basically what you said. It's gamers getting carried away with their imagination, and as gamers, that's what we want. We want to get carried away.
Yeah, we've all done that. I remember before I got a PC, reading an issue of PC Gamer or something like that, and it had a review or preview of Duke Nukem 3D, and I remember just sitting around for hours thinking about all the cool things I could do in Duke Nukem, like opening doors and drinking out of toilets and jumping out of windows, and I blew it up in my mind into this amazing experience. Now, Duke Nukem 3D was a good game, but it didn't live up to that amazing created experience in my mind. And that's exactly what people are doing with this game.
You know, many, many, many years ago when we first met each other, and we went to LAN parties, and we used to sit around on the chairs when we had a break, and we used to fantasize about our ideal game, and we talked about a game where it was kind of like you'd be able to set up a base. This is before any of these massively multiplayer games that you can do this in. You'd be able to set up a base, and you'd be able to have multiplayer people, you know, lots of people in there, and they'd be able to have some guy sat up and snipe from a tower, and you'd have some guy going around building bits of the base, and you have another guy doing this. And now we've got that, but it still does not live up to the dream that I had, because
Staying High had basically the same idea. I'm not going to say anything about it, but we basically had the same idea.
It was an awesome idea. It still is an awesome idea.
But that's the thing. It's an awesome idea, but unless you put it into practice, it's not. And you deliver on it, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen, and I don't think it can. I don't think it can. You can deliver the idea that's in your head practically as a developer without putting some constraints in place.
Yeah, that's the problem in the end, is that you can have a great idea, but then the realities of the idea.
My game that I'm still developing, which is unfortunately at the moment on a bit of a hiatus, I had really grand ideas for it. I mean, me and Lou initially talked about some ideas that have now completely went out the window with the development of it. But even the ideas I have now for the game, as I've got to a point where I'm nearly finishing the game and I've got a few little things to implement, I've now got to a point where I'm like, this doesn't feel anything like I originally thought it would. This isn't the same game that I originally put together. It feels good in its own way, but not, it's not what I wanted. I wanted a bustling city full of people and lots of dynamic things going on. Being able to implement that as an indie dev is difficult. It's very difficult. You've got more chance as a AAA dev, but then you've also got the bureaucracy and all of the, you know, the management saying, no, bottom lines, bottom lines, bottom line. You know, it's difficult to get a game that does what you want it to do.
Probably one of the only games like that that has actually been created is Dwarf Fortress. The developer of that has had free reign to basically make the game that he wants to make, and the only constraint he's put on himself is that it's basically all ASCII art. It's all text mode graphics, and because of that, because it frees him not to have to create models or anything, if he wants a new enemy, he just puts another different coloured symbol on the screen. He's been able to model things in amazing detail. Like, your dwarves can get injured and they can get a tendon severed in the left arm, and then they'll have the injury for that and stuff, and the detail is incredible. And he's been working on that game for years and years and years.
So I need to play this, because
the game that he wanted to make, and he's still making it.
This is another quote from the guy, from the No Man's Sky guy, the developer. A lot of other companies would have taken the interest, taken loads of investment, grown the team massively, and so on. And of course, we did talk about things like that, but it felt like it wouldn't work. We had an idea for a game, and we may never be able to deliver on the hype, but we can deliver the game that we set out to make, and that has to be enough. That's enough for him, personally, until he gets the criticism when it gets launched, I imagine.
See, I'm going to call bullshit on that, and I'm going to say that what they were trying to make was a cool idea to generate planets, to generate a universe, mm-hmm. and now they're trying to shoehorn a game into that. The game has been looking as it does for the last couple of years, maybe. I remember seeing something a while ago about it. And all that time, since the game hasn't really changed that much, it's just become an actual game that you can play now rather than one you can just explore. Yeah. Just like Minecraft. And I think that's why I'm calling bullshit. I don't think they set out to make a game. I think they set out to make a cool universe simulator and then realised they had to put a game in there. And that's like a lot of these sort of things.
Well, that, again, that's an indie problem as well, because without the experience and without the team behind you, or the creative directors and everybody else who can give you that input and give you the resource there, developers having to come up with all of the ideas as well as doing all the development, as well as probably organising a small team, or I don't even know how big his team is. It's bigger than him, though. It's got to be bigger than him now. I imagine it's quite difficult.
Hello Games, isn't it? So they're only a small company.
They're only small, but I bet they've had contractors in to help them with things, and you know, they've got 60 Days of Static doing the music and things like that, even though they're only a two-man team.
So that's
65. I'm awful, aren't I?
Just going back to the Dwarf Fortress thing, just as an example of how that one guy, Bay12 Games, is one guy who's been working it for years. What he does is he writes a story. So he writes a little story about something which would happen in the game, and then he programs the game to do that. So he adds all the stuff in necessary for that story to be able to happen in the game. And that's how development has progressed with Dwarf Fortress. He's written stories. People on the forums have written stories about dwarfs and about all the other races and stuff like that. And then the game has tried to simulate what happened in those stories.
Right.
And because of that, it's made it a really compelling game.
Right. Have you played it?
Yeah, I've played it quite a bit. It's a great game.
Is it multiplayer or is it single player?
Single player, and it's very difficult. It's got a really steep learning curve. The interface is all text-driven. You've got to press different keys for different menus and stuff like that. It's incredibly detailed, incredibly steep learning curve, but you start to realise the genius of how it can tax a modern CPU, despite the fact that it's basically, it looks like a DOS game, because it's simulating everything. Like, all of the skeletal and muscular integrity of every dwarf.
It's something that's been on my radar for a long, long time. I've heard about it ages ago. I initially thought it was some kind of 2D, 2D game, but I didn't realise until maybe a year back it was an ASCII game. But it appeals to me because it sounds interesting and different.
There's no other game like it. Well, maybe there's Nomori, I think, which is like a rip-off with proper graphics, but it's nowhere near the depth of Dwarf Fortress.
Yeah. Okay, so I think that will do for the day. It's been a fairly short show today, and we've waffled a little bit, but thanks to everyone who has been watching. We will catch you next week, Wednesday, 7:30, and hopefully we'll have a full team again. And hopefully we'll have a bit
and
more news.
And maybe some news.
Yeah, it's been really weird this week, hasn't it?
It's the dead slump after E3 where all of the developers in refractory period just kind of laid there going, Jesus Christ, give me a minute.
I can't be arsed with speaking to media. I've just spent spent a couple of days talking about it constantly.
Mythalos mentioned there's a texture pack for Dwarf Fortress. There's actually an app that sits beside it called Stone Sense, which gives you an isometric view of the game.
Right.
So it hooks into the memory and shows you a visual version of the game, which is pretty cool.
I'm presuming it's you pay for it. It's not a free.
No, it's free.
Is it?
It's free. Yeah, it's free.
I'll definitely get it then. There's no reason for me not to.
I warn you that you'll need to look at some tutorials on how to play it.
I'm sure I will, but I have got an attention span. I'm not one of these who looks at a game.
If you get into it, you'll really enjoy it. I think you'll be amazed at it.
I'll be the number one preacher of whatever. Evangelist.
You already look like a dwarf, just like a massive dwarf. So I think you've got that.
Awesome. Right, anyway, thank you very much, everybody, in chat, and we shall see you next week. If you're interested in anything we do and you haven't been to our website, www.resonancearcade.com, what are you laughing at now?
Corpse has just joined.
Corpse, you are awful. Absolutely awful. Get a watch or something. Anyway, right, so see everyone later. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter and everything else.
And a brand new website.
And a brand new, still brand. It's not brand new anymore. I changed that last week. It's alright, they're about 2 minutes behind, so by the time we finish, they'll be like, oh my god! Right, bye!
Bye!